Hello students, welcome to the fixed and fluidized bed experiment. In this experiment, we will be studying the flow through packed beds. Specifically, by varying the pressure drop versus flow rate, we will be verifying the Kozani-Karman equation. We will also witness the phenomenon of fluidization. Upon increasing the flow rate of fluid flowing upwards through this column, there will be a point when the drag forces acting upwards on these particles, measured as the pressure drop across the column, would balance the buoyancy forces on these particles. This would be the onset of fluidization. Upon further increasing the flow rate or the superficial velocity of fluids passing through the column, we will witness three different regimes of fluidization: the uniformly expanding, the bubbling fluidization, and the cohesive fluidization. So this is our experimental setup. As you can see, we have the three columns here. You have three transparent columns. Being transparent, we are able to see the level of the packed bed and the increase in level upon fluidization. We also have an instrumentation panel where different readings for pressure drops and flow rates will be taken. And lastly, the unit is connected to a PC where readings can be recorded. In these three columns, we have water being passed from the first column and air being passed through the second and the third columns. What is also different about these three columns is that the first two columns are filled with particles which are slightly larger in size. These are around 600 microns in diameter. These are glass beads. The third column is packed with finer glass beads. These beads are 250 microns in size and therefore much finer than the first set of beads. As you can see, each of these columns is fitted with two tappings for measuring the pressure drop for the fluid flowing across the column. You have one tapping at the base of the column and another at a certain height. The other end of the pressure tappings comes to this instrumentation unit, where a differential pressure gauge measures the pressure difference across these two points. We have a trough at the base of these three columns, which is filled with water. There is also a submerged centrifugal pump, which pumps this water through column number one. As you can see, the flow rate of water can be adjusted using this regulator. If the regulator is moved clockwise, you increase the flow of water, and by turning it anti-clockwise, you decrease the flow of water. The flow rate of water through the column is measured using a turbine flow meter, which is present in between the pump and the entrance to the column here. The pump can be started using the switch here. The rise of water through the column can be seen as the beads get wet and the water level rises here. Eventually, water will wet the entire column and will fill up the entire column and pass back to the trough below. The flow rate is displayed here. You can see 0.34 liter per minute flow of water, and the corresponding pressure drop can be seen here as around 17 millibar. Water fills up this entire column and there is an outlet provided for the overflow, as you can see here, and this water falls back into the trough and is recycled. flow of air to columns 2 and 3 is made possible via a high pressure air line. This line comes from a compressor, and the flow of air can be started by turning this valve on. After turning on the valve, we come to the regulator here for column 2. By turning the regulator slowly, we open the flow of air to column number 2. We turn on the regulator slowly. The airflow has started. At low flow, you can see air is passing through the column, but the particles are not moving at all. You can focus there. The top layer of particles is almost undisturbed. As flow rate is increased further, a point is reached where the topmost layer of particles begins to move due to the passage of air across it. As the flow is increased further, more and more particles start moving, and bubbles of air passing through the bed are also visible. Coming to column number 3, where fine particles have been filled in the column, we now begin to increase the flow of air through it. As we slowly turn the regulator, you see that initially all the particles are filled up to a certain height, which is around 309 mm here. As we increase the flow of air, some motion of particles in the topmost layer is visible. Coming to column number 3, where finer glass beads are packed, we can see that the initial height of the fixed bed is around 300 mm. We start the flow of air by turning the regulator clockwise. Initially, while air passes through the column, there isn't much change because the particles have not fluidized yet. But once you reach a certain critical velocity, you see that particles quickly get levitated, and the top layer of particles has now risen up to around 306, 307 mm. Flow of air through both the columns is measured using an orifice flow meter, which is fitted at the top. There's differential pressure measurement between two sides of the orifice, one using this tube and the other being atmospheric. The differential pressure measurement is then converted to mass flow rate of air through both the columns. The regime of fluidization depends on two parameters. One, the particle sizes, and two, the ratio of density of particle to the density of the fluid. As you can see, in columns 1 and 2, we have particles of the same diameter. Both are glass beads of the same size. However, the fluids are different. In one case, you have water, and the other, you have air. So while the particle sizes are the same, the density ratios are different. When we come to column 2 and 3, both these columns have air passing through them. However, the particle sizes are different. Column 2 has larger size particles as compared to In column 1, we have larger size beads and water is flowing through it. The density of glass beads being 2.5 gram per cc and the density of water being close to 1, the density ratio here is around 2.5. For this kind of density ratio, we expect to see a uniform onset of fluidization, and bed expansion can also be seen in this case. So as we increase the flow of water here, at the onset of fluidization, the bed of particles should uniformly rise, as can be seen happening here. As the flow of water is increased, the particles are levitated and the bed expands. The level of expansion increases with the flow rate of water. As the bed expands, it does so in a very uniform fashion with almost no heterogeneity seen. When complete fluidization occurs, you can see that the motion of individual particles in the column is as if they are like individual molecules in a fluid. They are free to move about, and hence the name of a fluidized bed. The nature of fluidization can also be seen by placing a rod on the stationary packed bed. As the bed is packed, the rod just remains on top of the bed. Now, if flow is started, the bed gets fluidized and the rod sinks in. And the rod is now free to move in the entire bed because it's behaving like a fluid with very little resistance to movement of the rod. At this point, if flow is switched off, the bed comes back into its packed state and now the rod is stuck. It requires some effort to pull the rod out because it's now facing the frictional resistance from the packed bed around it. In your experiments, you will also witness a hysteresis between the onset of fluidization, that is the velocity at which fluidization occurs, versus the reverse path, that is the velocity at which fluidization stops. You may report this as a part of your observations. Now we come to column 2. As you remember, the particles used here are exactly the same as those in column 1. The only difference here is that we will use air to fluidize these particles instead of water. Now the density of glass being 2500 and that of air being 1 kg per meter cube, we have a density ratio of 2500 in this case as compared to a density ratio of 2.5 in column 1. In this case, you will witness that as the onset of fluidization occurs, the column immediately goes into a bubbling fluidization regime. The airflow rate is being increased here and the top layer of particles is just beginning to move. And immediately, the presence of bubbles can be seen on the surface. You can contrast this from what was seen in column number 1, where the entire bed was rising uniformly. Immediately upon fluidization, you can see bubbles, large slug-like bubbles of air traveling through the height of the column. And as they do so, the bed height expands as the bubble rises and contracts as soon as the bubble is released. This is known as the bubbling fluidization regime. As the velocity of air is increased even further, the size of these slugs increases further until you will be able to see that almost the entire cross section of the column gets filled with the air bubble. And you can almost see a transparent layer in the center of the column as the bubble is rising. It's as if the entire pack of particles above the bubble is rising as a solid. As the velocity is increased even further, you can see that the bed becomes more and more turbulent, providing a good level of mixing for the particles in the column. Because of the good level of mixing achieved in such fluidized beds, these can be used for reactions as well. So the particles could be catalysts, whereas the air could be carrying reactants with it. Such a bed provides good mixing between the gas passing through it as well as the catalyst particles. Such a concept is used in what is known as a fluidized catalytic cracker, which contains catalyst particles and is used for cracking the petroleum components into smaller molecules, and is present in almost every modern refinery. Now we come to column number 3. In contrast to column 2, we have smaller size particles here. The size of particles here is around 250 microns as compared to 600 odd microns in column 2. However, the medium of fluidization remains the same, that is air. So density ratio is still high, however, particle sizes are smaller. You will see that for smaller particle sizes, the regime of fluidization still remains somewhat heterogeneous. However, it's not as clearly in the bubbling regime as you can see in the column 2. In column 3, as we increase the flow of air, you can see that the bed expands uniformly initially. There is a small extent of bubbling that is seen. However, by carefully controlling the flow of air, we can witness some regime of uniform fluidization where the bed expands uniformly. Beyond the initial regime of uniform expansion, if the flow rate is increased further, here as well, you will enter into a bubbling regime. You can see the bubbles getting formed at the bottom of the column and getting bigger in size as they go up. At these flow rates, the similarity between the fluidization regimes achieved in column 2 with the larger size particles versus column 3 with the finer size particles can be seen. Like we witnessed for the case in column 1, where particles were fluidized with water, here too, when a rod is dropped onto the bed of particles, it remains stuck at the top. However, when the bed is fluidized, you can see that the rod begins to sink and it goes all the way to the bottom. In summary, we have seen how pressure drop and flow rates are measured across the three columns. These readings are recorded on the instrumentation panel. By varying the pressure drop and flow rate for the three different columns, you will verify the Kozani-Karman equation. The flow rate and the superficial velocity corresponding to the onset of fluidization can also be measured. Lastly, three different regimes of fluidization are seen here. The uniformly expanding for the case of water fluidizing the larger beads in column 1. The bubbling fluidization regime for the case of air fluidizing the larger particles. And third, column number 3, the cohesive fluidization where air is fluidizing the smaller glass beads.